Experiment 4 in Chem 1310 is titled Exploring Gas Laws, and the purpose of this experiment is to get familiar with the ideal gas law and its various manifestations when we hold different variables within the law constant. So while you may think this experiment is about gases and their properties, and it is to some degree, just as important is an appreciation for experimental design and experimental variables. So we'll talk a lot in this video about how we measure the different properties of gases, what we choose as dependent and independent variables, and how that influences experimental design, so that when you get into the laboratory and have to design your own experiment, for example, to determine the ideal gas constant R, you'll be comfortable working with the different variables that are important to gases and designing your own experiment. In the first part of Experiment 4, we'll investigate Boyle's law using a simple apparatus involving a syringe and a pressure gauge. Boyle's law says that the product of pressure and volume of a gas is equal to a constant. And if you've ever pumped up a bike tire, for example, or used an air pump, you're intimately familiar with Boyle's law. As we pump up a tire, what happens is that we push down on the plunger and we compress air so that it moves into the tire. But as you add more and more air and try to compress a larger and larger volume of air into a smaller and smaller space, what we find is that the pressure increases and you encounter resistance as you try to add more and more air. That feeling of the tire getting harder and harder to fill with air as you add more and more and more into the space inside the tire is a manifestation of Boyle's law in action. We're trying to take a very large volume of gas and cram it into a very small space, which leads to a large increase in pressure. Pressure and volume, then, are inversely related. We'll construct what's essentially a very simple air pump with no outlet using a syringe and a pressure gauge. So by attaching the pressure gauge to the end of the syringe and sealing the system off, as we push down on the plunger, we compress the volume of the gas, and we can use the pressure gauge to measure the resulting pressure due to that compression. So in the first part of this experiment, we'll systematically vary the plunger position, measure the volume using the markings on the side of the syringe, and record the pressure that's measured by a LabQuest pressure gauge. In that way, we can generate a graph of volume on the x-axis and pressure on the y-axis and see how pressure varies with changes in volume. We'll also plot 1 over pressure versus volume, and note that according to Boyle's law, this ought to be a straight line if Boyle's law is obeyed, because volume is equal to k times 1 over pressure, or just k divided by pressure. So that should be a straight line if Boyle's law is obeyed. In the second part of the experiment, we'll do an empirical determination of the ideal gas constant R. The ideal gas law says that pressure times volume is equal to number of moles times the ideal gas constant times the temperature, or the famous PV equals NRT. A little bit of rearrangement of this equation shows us that the ideal gas constant is equal to the ratio of pressure times volume and number of moles times temperature. So if we can measure all the variables on the right-hand side, then we have in hand a measure of the ideal gas constant R. To do this in practice, we need to understand what are the dynamic variables that can change and what are the variables that we can design to be fixed. So for example, the pressure is a variable that we really have to measure, and it's something that's going to be dynamic. It's not something that we can directly control. We can't tell the gas molecules, for example, to press harder against the walls of their container without changing any of the other variables, volume, temperature, or number of moles. So pressure we're going to have to measure using a gauge. The volume is perhaps the easiest variable of all to keep fixed. All we have to do is use a rigid vessel, like a piece of glassware that's been sealed off. The volume accessible to the gas is just the volume inside of this rigid vessel. Because the walls are rigid, that volume is constant throughout the experiment. The temperature, likewise, is also fixed, and it's just the room temperature. If we make sure that the gas inside of our apparatus has enough time to reach thermal equilibrium with the room, then we know the temperature of the gas inside of that flask is equal to the room temperature on the outside. And finally, the number of moles of gas that we have on the inside is known if we use a known reaction to generate the gas. In this experiment, we'll use the reaction of magnesium solid, or magnesium ribbon, with aqueous hydrochloric acid. When these two compounds are combined, the products are magnesium chloride and hydrogen gas. And so we can use this reaction to determine the number of moles of hydrogen gas. Specifically, if we know the moles of magnesium that we added, which we will because we'll mass it, and we know the number of moles of hydrochloric acid we added, which again we will because we'll know its concentration and the volume of solution that we add, then a little bit of stoichiometry gives us the number of moles of hydrogen that should be generated, assuming the reaction goes to 100% completion, which is a fine assumption in this case. So we know the number of moles of hydrogen gas that are generated by this reaction, and if we assume that that gas takes up the entire volume of the container and has the same temperature of the room, then we can measure the pressure change upon the generation of that gas to determine its pressure. At the end of the reaction, we'll be left with an aqueous solution of magnesium chloride and the hydrogen gas in the headspace above the solution. So there are four different gases inside this system at the end of this reaction, and that's important to realize. First of all, there's the air that we started with. And of course, you'll have the pressure gauge in the system initially, and it's important to record that initial pressure because that's the pressure due to air. That partial pressure is not going to change when we run the reaction, but it's still important to subtract that out from the final pressure we measure. Then, of course, we'll have the hydrogen gas that's generated by the reaction in that empty space above the solution. And the last gas that's important to consider is water vapor. Upon introducing water in the form of the hydrochloric acid solution, some water vapor is going to evaporate from the surface of the liquid, and it's important to, again, subtract the pressure of the water vapor from the measured pressure so that ultimately we can calculate the pressure due to H2 alone. We don't know the moles of water, and we don't know the moles of nitrogen and oxygen in air. The only number of moles we really know is that of H2, so we need to subtract out the pressures due to the other gases so that we can match the pressure with the number of moles. In the final part of the experiment, you'll design an experimental system to determine the relationship between pressure and temperature for a gas. According to the ideal gas law, when all the other variables are held constant, pressure and temperature are directly or linearly related, P equals KT. The purpose of this part of the experiment is to verify that relation for air. So ultimately, the product of this part will be a graph of pressure on the y-axis and temperature on the x-axis. It's up to you to design the experimental apparatus for this, but I'll give you a couple of guidelines here. First of all, we talked already about how we can't really control pressure independent of the other important variables, temperature, number of moles, and volume. The only way to change pressure, in fact, typically is to change one of those other experimental variables. Because of that, in this part of the experiment, pressure should serve as the dependent variable. We have no way to control it, so all we can really do is measure it and measure its response to the independent variable, which here, by default, is temperature. You'll also want to think, when you're designing this experiment, how to hold volume and number of moles fixed. This is important because if volume and number of moles are changing at the same time as pressure and temperature, then we can't isolate changes in pressure as due only to a temperature change. That's important if we really want to ascertain the effect of temperature only on pressure. According to the ideal gas law, this graph of pressure versus temperature should be linear. And if you don't see linearity in some section of the graph or even over the entire set of points, think about errors that can come into play here. And in particular, think about the nature of gases and the way they tend to expand to fill their containers. Errors that creep into this experiment can be due to the somewhat difficult nature of dealing with gases in terms of isolating them within containers and making sure that none of them are lost in the course of an experiment.